so it doesn't like fall off things. And let's see. Yeah. So are you able to see me and the slide? Are you able to see me?
Yeah.
Okay. What about the...
I get partial. I get...
Okay.
I can... No.
One.
No, it's good. I get like... Yeah, nothing really gets cut off.
You're
good. Yeah.
Okay, so
it's dark now. Like I can't really see you. Like I can see the slide really well, but I can't see you.
Yeah.
You don't care?
I guess that's okay. You yeah. So it's recording.
It's recording.
It's redness. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So this presentation I gave. Year ago, this is a much more sizable audience at that time, and Trish Campbell was there, a bunch of other people. And I'm telling you, this year's better in a lot of ways, amazing that so much could change in a year. Last year I made a big point of the fact that there was all this built-in, maybe subconscious resistance to the ideas of regenerative medicine and tissue engineering, manifested specifically by the fact that at the 2015 Cutting Edge of Transplantation meeting, there was a scheduled session on that everybody except me from Western Canada went sightseeing instead of going to that session. So I mean, there was a very select group, but nobody that I really knew very well, and nobody from Western Canada. So kind of a dramatic example of the fact that you can give a teaching session, but if none of the right people come, you don't really accomplish much. But a year later, so the Canadian Society of Transplantation, if you go to their meeting in Halifax in 2 weeks' time, it's completely intermixed with the Regenerative Medicine Society, Cell Therapy Regenerative Medicine Society. They're co-equal partners in that meeting. There's just as many posters from the one as from the other. They're mixed. All the sessions are like joint. So there's no escape. If you go to Halifax this year, everybody who goes is going to be exposed to the ideas of stem cell replacement of organs and stem cell repair of organs. That's just the way it is. And the next Banff meeting, the next Banff transplant pathology meeting, probably the most exciting part of the meeting is the pre-meeting, the one-day thematic beginning of the meeting. And in 2019, that's devoted to regenerative medicine, tissue engineering, pathology. So there literally is, a year later, after I was complaining so much last year about how everybody was avoiding thinking about this, suddenly there's no escape. You have to kind of accept that this is mainstream, it's a part of the future, it's, you know, something that you bump into every time you go to a major meeting in your specialty area. And that's not the only surprising thing that happened in a year. So last year I mentioned that we have started this initiative called The Future and All That Jazz, that takes the ideas from the Technology and Future Medicine course, mixes them with poetry and music as a way of trying to broaden the audience for a lot of important messages in science that I think most people would never sit still for a lecture on if they knew beforehand. If they saw a sign in the hallway, you know, come in and hear about stem cell generation of organs or, you know, regenerative medicine or tissue engineering, they would suddenly discover that they need to wash their hair or there's something else really important in their lives that just absolutely prevents them from going. But if you mix the same themes into poetry and music, you can get the same ideas across. But I would have thought last year that the chances I can actually sell that idea to a large group of people is like almost zero. But we did. So this year, the Termas meeting, which is the biggest tissue engineering meeting organization in the world, has accepted for the first time that they're going to have entertainment at their meeting. They never had entertainment of any kind, none, not a nothing, no entertainment of any kind, and they've chosen us as the only entertainment. And so we're going to be entertaining people for 2 hours in the exhibit area on the second day of the meeting as a way to bring people to the exhibits and the posters and stuff. And then the next day, we're going to be entertaining them for 3 hours in the NASCAR Hall of Fame, which is the biggest building where you can have a function in Charlotte, North Carolina. So it's really exciting and unexpected that we would have actually sold this idea so readily and so quickly. So one of the reasons Argo Dukes here is that suddenly I realize I need to make this happen. I need to get a full team of poets and musicians together. So what am I telling people? I need to confess this to you. I'm telling them that I'm kind of like the Pied Piper, that I'm leading transplant physicians and transplant pathologists into regenerative medicine, tissue engineering. So I don't know if you feel I'm doing that to you, that's what I'm telling people that I'm doing. And it really works for them because the big problem at the Termas meeting is they don't get enough physician attendees. They get a lot of like PhDs and, you know, people working on master's or PhD degrees. But the average physician feels too isolated. They don't find enough other physicians there and so on. So they're hopeful that through my activities, the number of MDs at the meeting will go up and that will improve everything about the meeting. Unless you think these two slides are like, what could there possibly be else that happened in the last year? But the other thing that's so unexpected, I want to ask for a show of hands because it's probably embarrassing, but a lot of people in medicine are not on Facebook or believe it to be evil or they're only secretly there or they're pretending not to be there or whatever. But the most exciting thing that's happened in the last year, you cannot find out about by going to the usual meetings. It's called the Human Cell Atlas Project. It's potentially bigger than the Human Genome Project. It's the identification of the genetic code of all the individual cells of the body to find out how many actual cell types there are, what they do, what their activation state is. You can do it in fluid, where you're looking at one cell at a time. You can do it in tissue, or you can do it in situ and look at, you know, relationships between cells. Are they genetically identical? Are they different? And it turns out in every organ, including the kidney, there are a lot more cell types than people ever thought. And cell types that were thought to be homogeneous are regularly shown to contain 2, 3, 4, or 5 types. So we're going to learn a tremendous amount about what the human body is really made of. And it's quick and it's cheap. It's like a second per cell to analyze the cells, about 15 cents. And the throughput that they've been able to arrive at 2017 is really, really interesting. So does the name Chan Zuckerberg mean anything to you? This is the guy who owns Facebook, that's his wife, and they have a fund, which is quite a generous fund for supporting things, and they are supporting the Human Cell Atlas. It's supported by lots of other things. It's supported by the Wellcome Trust and the NIH and, you know, so on. It has a lot of traditional support. But what was really cool for me, I happened not to go to the USCAP meeting this past year, the US Canadian Academy of Pathology. This is like the major meeting for, you know, pathologists. And you would think anything new would be there. So I stayed home. This stuff was on Facebook about the Human Cell Atlas project. And I realized that this funding is, like, you know, amazing. They get more money from Facebook than anybody's gotten from, you know, the NIH or anything. And Facebook is not only helping them with that, but, you know, logistics of getting other people to work with them and so on. There's no precedent for this. Okay, so I didn't go to the USCAP meeting. Was there anything about this at the USCAP meeting? Absolutely not. There was nothing about single-cell genomics, the way that this is going to change pathological practice in all organs everywhere in the world. I think it's kind of amusing to think about. People who are studiously avoiding Facebook are going to be completely blindsided by this. They're not going to know about it for years because of the fact that it's going through a whole different communication stream. And so anyway, that's the other big thing that happened in 2017. So what am I planning for 2021? So 2021 is the 30th year of Banff, and people are telling me we should do something really important and stuff. So I want to get the main lady who's doing this. She's about 30, a really amazing young woman who has done this Human Cell Atlas project. I want to get her to come to Banff and speak. I think she'll be a wonderful role model for everybody else there. And so anyway, those are sort of like the new things. So stem cell technologies on Google Trends, you may be familiar with three terms. There's regenerative medicine, there's tissue engineering, and there's cell therapy. And this shows how they have trended over a period of years. So you can see that regenerative medicine sort of stays constant at that. It's a term that's used. Tissue engineering is becoming less used, and cell therapy has increased in use. They're often used for the same thing. Urine transplantation. Why should you care about this? I'm very proud of the advances in transplantation, as you are. But if you step back and sort of think of the big picture, we only provide organs to 10% of the people who need them. Most people die waiting for organs. And so I don't know if you ever thought of it that way, but that is really the way it is. And so what could regenerative medicine do? So every year, 1.2 million people are in need of transplantation for end-stage organ failure, and we could potentially provide organs to all of them, every single one, through regenerative medicine. There's no particular reason why the number of organs would be limited. You can say that, well, but won't it be just for the rich and, you know, won't it cost a lot of money? But remember that televisions cost a lot when they were new the first year, right? And cell phones and so on. So yes, maybe initially the costs will be high, but I think if properly managed, it will come down. So everybody has that access. In a sense, regenerative medicine is already here. It already works for tubular organs, bladder, esophagus, vagina, and this shows a tissue-engineered bladder. For those of you who were here last year, you may notice that there's something left off of this slide. That is trachea. The pictures of the tissue-engineered trachea were like, they would draw audiences like you can't imagine. They looked so cool, and so, wow, imagine stem cells creating that. But the guy who was doing most of that work was a kind of charlatan doctor who most of his patients died, and he hid the fact that they died horrible deaths and so on. So the trachea regenerative medicine history up until now is not as positive as it has seemed. And that's been a huge scandal. So anyway, I still have that slide of the trachea. It's still as beautiful as it was. I'm not going to show it again. And you might think, well, here we are. We're in Edmonton. We're off the U.S. map. You know, does anything important happen here? There's lots of important things happening here. The Viacite trial of pancreatic progenitor cells. James Shapiro is the PI of one of the largest arms of that study. So there is regenerative medicine progress going on right around you. And then what about the other side? What about the critique? What about the problems? Well, that is also an area of University of Alberta excellence. Timothy Caulfield knows more about stem cell hype, stem cell fraud, stem cell tourism, all the bad things about poorly documented stem cell therapies that are the biggest regulatory challenge for Health Protection Canada and the FDA. So that's why you need things like the future and all that jazz to get people to get thinking about this, because when you just start telling people about it, it's not simple enough. You can't present it in a way that's just totally positive, totally negative, because there are all these various facets. Regenerative medicine is the greatest hope for the future of medicine. It's also where the most medical fraud, where the most intellectual dishonesty in publishing occurs. So it's a very complex issue. And Timothy Caulfield has really important publications every year having to do with this sort of thing. The celebrity impact on general acceptance of science ideas, but a lot of stem cell specific things. And how does this impact the field of transplantation, the field of renal medicine? I think it potentially provides a solution to really all the problems that you may be thinking about. The loss of luster in transplantation. When my career began, go to a cocktail party and you listen to the surgeons, and they were so proud of being transplant surgeons. There was nothing better. They were talking about, you know, in a room like this, you can tell who the surgeons are. They have a special extra bounce in their step, and you know, and I would say that at that time everybody agreed they had a lot to be proud of. Well, to some extent that's been lost. The workforce problems in renal medicine worldwide, and the idea of machine replacement of human labor. You can imagine that stem cell therapies will correct for people in transplantation and renal medicine, all three of those problems. That it's just complicated enough that I don't think, you know, machines are going to be able to figure out what we should be doing in this field for quite a while. So there's a role for sentient humans for quite a long time. So this is a joke, but you sort of get the idea that transplant physicians, nephrologists, renal pathologists may be the only people still employed in 2045 when robots have taken over most other jobs. So I talked about the new Banff classification. Is this just like an extension of the current Banff classification? No, I'm talking about something entirely new. So the Banff classification as it is has to do with transplantation pathology. And the Banff classification of tissue engineering pathology would have to do with the abnormalities seen in stem cell generated organs. The two don't overlap very much. Which field will be bigger, do you think? In theory, the new Banff classification of tissue engineering pathology will describe something tenfold bigger, right? Because we're only providing organs to 10% of the people who actually require them. So the field could be 10 times larger, 10 times better funding. It could be something really, really exciting. So if you look at the publications related to the current Banff classification, it's amazing that it keeps going up. So I have been doing this for 26 years, right? You would think most people have been doing something for 26 years. It's like, yes, I'm still doing that old thing. And the number of publications should start to go down. But I think that not only is it continuing to go up, but when we add this new consideration, this new entity, if you were to search in any pathology textbook today, tissue engineering pathology, it is not there. I intend in the next 2 or 3 years it'll be in all of them. So it's really something new, it's something important, it's something that sort of you're finding about first. So the Banff process, that's something else that you may not have realized. You probably are vaguely aware the NIH has been doing consensus conferences. They've been doing that for a long time. But did you know they gave them up forever in 2013? They stopped because they were having a number of problems of having like charismatic cult figures who were sort of moving the whole field in the wrong direction at an NIH consensus conference and things like that. So we haven't had those problems. I guess it may just be luck, but what I'm quite proud of is the fact that now if you go to the NIH and they say, we want to have a consensus conference, they'll say, we don't do that anymore. Talk to the Banff people. And so that's us. So if you compare the size of the NIH to us, it's like, it's an amazing thing that we would have created something that actually works better than something that they had created. I'm not quite sure how that happened, but it did. So our latest meeting was in Barcelona. I don't know how many of you remember this cover of HAT, November 2014. But it was really like the first regenerative medicine cover of HAT. And it meant, to me, if you put things on the cover, it means it's pretty mainstream. This is not just something strange and weird. This is something that's really happening. So from that moment onward, you could argue that regenerative medicine is a legitimate mainstream part of transplantation. And so ideas like this of like starting with cells, putting the cells in the scaffold. Where does the scaffold come from? It can be an organ that was in a person or an animal before. You flushed out all the cells. Or it can be something that's totally artificial. And then you add bioactive factors and you get sort of a new organ forming then in that scaffold. And there's different signs to all of these. Now, you may be thinking, yeah, I bet that science is like inferior to our science. What I want to tell you is kind of interesting. In pathology, we take a lot of pictures, but there's not a lot of training in how to take pictures. There's training in, you know, pathology, but not in how to take pictures of it. And if you compare the pictures of pathologic material taken by people in the field of materials science, those pictures are much better than the average anatomical pathologist pictures of the same slides. Because they're trained in, you know, photography, they think it's important, they know that the background should always be white, that you should have, you had the proper lighting and so on. So I'm not sure that their science is inferior to ours. What I can tell you is in a lot of these areas, like scaffolds, bioactive factors, there's a tremendous amount of work going on outside of medicine. It's being done mainly by PhDs in these other fields. And it's meetings like Terminus and like the meeting that's coming up in Halifax that bring these people together. And I felt that, the world is changing rapidly. People need to be kind of have their consciousness jump started to some extent. I keep asking, is this an inappropriate slide? I don't want to be giving presentations with an inappropriate slide, but people don't feel that it is yet. So, what does the Canadian public want? It's quite interesting that if you survey people about their feelings about radical life extension, regenerative medicine, tissue engineering, the average Canadian is quite positive on these things. So, we're in a sense, by pursuing this, we're doing what the Canadian population wants. And I teach a lot about this idea of the technological singularity, where machines become smarter than we are, and so on. But really, in medicine, successful application of regenerative medicine, successful generation of organs from stem cells is really the medical equivalent of the technological singularity. It's that tremendously exciting change in the field that really alters everything from that point onward. So existing animal models, you may be aware of this paper of Song et al. From Nature in 2013. And so it's a regenerative rat kidney. And they talk about the kidney making primitive urine. Okay, so they're perfusing it with something that has no blood, and there's fluid coming out. So a pure leak of the perfusion fluid is, if you will, the most primitive urine you could possibly have, right? So that's the thing, is a little trick in that paper, that they couldn't detect bleeding because there's no blood going through the kidney in the first place. So they're just looking at transport and various other things that the kidney should do. But it's very interesting what happens to the cells. The cells get all mixed up about where they should be. So podocytes, those brown staining cells here, should be entirely covering the glomerular capillaries. It shouldn't be anywhere else. But they go out wandering in the interstitium, And so there are many other things like that. The wrong cells are the wrong places. But if you think back to what I said in the third slide about the human cell atlas, when we say wrong cell in wrong place, that assumes that we know what the normal cells of the kidney are. And right now, we don't. We have sort of a list of cell types we think are in the normal kidney, but it turns out there are a lot more than that, that if you look at the actual genetics of the cells, there may be twice as many different types of cells. And when this Human Cell Atlas project is farther along, we'll have a much better understanding of how the kidney works, what the cell types are, what they're actually doing, how tumors begin. And this is going to revolutionize pathology, medicine, regenerative medicine, you know, whatever field any of you are in is going to be revolutionized by. So there are many problems with stem cell-generated organs that are not being discussed. For instance, in the liver, a lot of the problems of the wrong cells in the wrong places don't matter quite as much in the liver. It's not like a series circuit, you know, you don't need fluid to go through just one path. But it's almost impossible to perfuse a regenerated liver without the vessels clotting within a very short time. And the solutions to that have been very impractical, you know, to completely like heparin coat vascular surfaces and so on. These are soluble problems, but the fact is that as long as in any audience, a number of the health professionals there are thinking, this has nothing to do with me, the more people think that, the longer it's going to take to solve all these problems. They can move us from the point that we're at now, where we kind of know what we want to do, to the point where we're actually successfully doing it. So I don't want any of you to kind of count yourself out of the running as somebody who could help with this. And we need to get people actually discussing. Okay, if we think it's like cell phones or TVs, it can be expensive in the beginning, but how did that actually happen? How did it happen that people decided that every human being basically should have access to a cell phone or a TV rather than only rich people? You know, how can we make sure that that happens here? So it isn't just external entities. I'm the chair of the Banff Foundation. We need to adapt to this. We need to make future plans related to it. And so since 2011, I've been telling people about this, predicting that their lives would change, that, you know, eventually they will no longer regard themselves as transplant physicians or transplant pathologists, but as tissue engineering pathologists, regenerative medicine physicians. So that change is coming. It's not like beyond our generation. It's coming soon. So the classification that we've begun to work on, the focus is on sustaining life. I was kind of amused. The very first classification, which was kind of a death classification, was all about death and how people died and all that kind of thing. I don't think that's a good orientation. So how to sustain life. So this is a kidney tubule and one of those regenerated kidneys from Solez. And can imagine that that might work, but it's pretty odd. You've got all those interconnecting pathways. It shouldn't just be a single lumen, but you've got a very complex picture there. And then you've got lots of areas of the interstitium that should have cells that don't. You've got a glomerulus here with many fewer cells than it should have. And as I showed you before, you've got podocytes wandering in the interstitium. So Corey Fung, who is undergraduate student who importantly did these pencil sketches of all the different considerations here. And it looks like the article is going to be published with a professional artist redoing the art based on his pencil sketches, which is exactly what we always intended. So I